Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome in this sunny afternoon here in Wilrijk. It's nice to have open source people around, and well, it was already a nice 2 days. So hopefully this presentation will fulfill its goal to make it some interesting part. I will talk about Relax and Recover automated testing. It's a two-folded presentation effect because first of all, it's a little bit about Relax and Recover. My first question is, you may always interrupt me and ask me a question. And my first question to you is anybody of here using already Relax and Recover? No. Okay. So that means that my first part is still useful for most of the people here present. And the second part is a bit about the automated testing. But okay, let's continue and then. All right, I already said what it is, and the third part is a live demonstration. So it's live, and you will see it, I will explain it while we are going through the presentation. I think most people here already know me. For those who don't, okay, you can find my information on the internet. Okay, I'm an old guy. I used to call myself senior. No, I don't want to do that anymore because it becomes too little. Right. So Relax and Recover, part one. It's about disaster recovery, and that's in that area here. But disaster recovery is only a tiny piece of the complete picture, and the complete picture is in fact a circle. It's business continuity as a whole effect. And I already gave once a talk about it, and it's quite interesting. It's about prevention and risk management. You can avoid a lot of errors, stupid errors, by looking at it and try to prevent them. And to prepare yourself, do a business impact analysis and so on and so on. It's too complicated for here, it's not interesting enough. A response team, in case you have a disaster, you need people to work on it. So when a disaster occurs, you may not look for people anymore. You must have a list and you must be able to call them, and they must be prepared. So that is here. And these people are known and working on it. And these people, in fact, are using the recovery plans. And in that area, you can find Relax and Recover. Okay? We can continue. Hopefully, it's not the Titanic. If a disaster occurs, your data center, but you have a business plan and you know what to do. And the effect is, act immediately, you have to take it very literally. You have to know exactly what you have to do at a given time when there is a disaster, right? But this is not the goal of today to talk about that. Talk about is about Relax and Recover and how we do the automated testing. But to differentiate, a lot of people still saying we have good backups. And I always say backups are not enough. And this is a slide that explains it quite well. If you have a disaster, you have to restore a system, and you do it on the old way. You have to restore your OS, whatever. You have to install the backup software. You have to install also or configure your backup software. Otherwise, you cannot do a full restore for data. And then you still have to do your playbooks or whatever you have to do, or config management stuff. In case of Relax and Recover, this part is effect here. And the only thing that you still have to do is a restore of the incrementals, because you do on timestamps, you make a snapshot of your image. And you still have to do the replace of the resize. So the time scale decreases a lot. And that is the important part of disaster recovery. Have your system up and running very quickly. All right. Okay. Relax and Recover is an open source software that was developed in 2006. It was not new. It was, in fact, the new form of disaster recovery for Linux. It was previously Makecd-ROM recovery. It was written in 2000, I believe. It is completely written in Bash because it's a program. Listen very carefully. Program for system administrators. We believe that any person should be able to work with it, if you are skilled or not skilled. Right. Maybe not the most fancy language, but okay. It is quite popular in that sense that we get a lot of pull requests from different people that do a lot of things with it. You can extend it easily because it's so open. It's a framework. You can integrate it with different kind of technologies. You can integrate it with different kind of software, backup software. And the thing is that we try to do is to make it as easy as possible for the system administrator. Okay? It's not a fancy tool with GUIs. It's a command line tool. But it is tended to be extremely easy to use. And that's why the Relax comes from. Disaster recovery should be a relaxed exercise. Relax and recover. So now you know where the name is coming from. How does it work? It's quite easy. You do it on a live system. Your system doesn't have to go down. You can do it anytime. You can put it in a scheduler, in cron, do it weekly, daily, monthly, whatever. In fact, it does. It saves the disk layout because your operating system has to be restored. Normally, you only do the system disks, but that can be extended. Of course, everything what has to be included in the disks is the file structures, the partitioning, the RAID volumes, LVM, whatever. Everything is recorded and can be restored afterwards. Also the bootloader, and then we store the files. The internal backup mechanism is using TAR, GNU TAR, that's the simplest form, but that can be extended with rsync and with whatever backup software there is on the market almost. And of course, the most important thing, we create a bootable rescue image from your current system. So it's not version X that we always use, it's from your live system that we make a bootable image. So you always have the same one-to-one relationship. Can be done online, already told you that. So the rescue, sorry, question? In principle, yes. But in theory, that's not always necessary because relaxing cover has been enhanced that it can use a central configuration. And that if you have 1,000 systems, they are all alike. Okay, that you just use a central configuration which is coming from a HTTP server, web server, whatever, or even on a NAS, and you can just continue. Yeah. That's possible. But I must say, then the majority of the customers or clients or users are using one-to-one relationship and they have a big NAS server. But okay. Or they use a central backup system and they only have a rescue image. Okay. This is the rescue image. So it's a bootable image from your live system. It contains everything about your system. So the disk, everything around the disks, the kernels, the drivers, the network configuration, basic tools that you need to recover, and you can extend it as far as you want. There are basic, simple configuration files that you can just add as many applications that you want. And everything is running in RAM. That's nice. If you want to recover something, you have to do it outside your system, so it's in RAM. Okay. Basically, it looks like this, the disaster recovery flow. This is your system that you want an image from. The output stream, we call it the output stream, is your rescue image. So your bootable image. That can be an ISO, that can be USB, can be Pixie booting. That's all supported. And then you have the backup stream. Already mentioned the internal stream, which is using TAR or rsync, which is the default TAR. And you have the external ones. That's you define yourself which kind of backup you want to use to backup your data. It can be anything. Anything that is integrated. If it's not integrated, that is request restore, and that's a generic flow that does exist, that you say, okay, I just want to rescue image, and you do it yourself. That's also possible. All right. How do we use it? Rear has some subcommands. we call it the make rescue, is to make the only the rescue image. The make backup is the rescue image including the backup. You can also see only the backup, and the to do the disaster recovery itself is the recover subcommand. Okay? And you can enhance it with a lot of other stuff. But okay, that is more typical for Rear. Rear is using a framework, and it's a kind of, you can see it as subdirectories. And in the subdirectory, you can put a simple script, and the script will be picked up at a certain point in time. It's a kind of flow that it is following. Okay? So Rear is available on the web. For those that are using CentOS or RHEL, it is included there in the basic OS. So if you just do a yum install Rear, you get the 2.0 version from Red Hat, which is a fork from the 2.0 version from... I know. For Debian, Ubuntu is there. Also for SLES, for those that use SUSE, it's also in there. We have for Rear, I already gave a talk years ago about Rear here. I'm one of the main designers, together with Shlomo Shapiro from Berlin in Germany. But in the meantime, there are different people coming and going. Dag Wiers, for example, who gave a talk yesterday. He worked on Rear 5 years ago, quite extensively. Did some very good things together with a colleague of him for the federal police. They did a lot of stuff. They're using USB disaster recovery over there. But okay, developers come and go. And now we have some few good people who are there already for a couple of years. One from SUSE, who's working 80% of his time on Rear. We have a guy from IBM who's working, let's say, 25%, because Rear is booming up in the PowerPC and PowerVM environment. They made a lot of advertising, IBM, and on conferences, and now a lot of customers are asking about it. And we also have a guy from, used to be HPE, but now it's DXC from Slovenia working on it. So we have a couple of good... people involved in Rear, and there are other people who are making pull requests for new features, stuff like that. Like ARM64 is one of the newer ones that is included. Yeah.
So when you restore an image, what I wondered, what's the advantage of the file system which has new UIDs and the Ethernet or new MAC address? Is this being dealt with?
That is all included.
Well,
That's why Rear is complexer than you think it is, because there are different distributions with different characteristics of doing things, and that all has to be known within Rear, even from different kinds of versions, because RHEL 5, 6, and 7, quite different. And these are the simple ones. Okay, whatever. So Rear is very good supported on the x86 Intel AMD platform. Also AI64, but okay, that's the past. Say PowerPC is there, and it's, I must say, in the past it was supported, not supported, but now we can say it is 100% supported, because we have an IBM guy working on it. When there is an issue, he's working on it, and it is fixed. ARM64 is now also in the booming, let's say, and it is already incorporated. I'm not 100% aware about the if it's 100% working or not, because I'm not really involved in that architecture, but okay, it will come for sure. Okay. Before we jump into the automated testing, testing Rear, because it's now already more than 10 years, and from 2006 until now available, was always a problem. Due to the fact there are different architectures, different versions of distributions, and etc., it was a pain testing. So therefore, automating that help us if we make a new release. Well, a new release in HitGut, we make a new branch or whatever. Testing that is very important, and we cannot test everything at the same time, and that takes time. Even if we make a new release, bug fixes are important afterwards. So it is a problem, and it will stay a problem in the future. I'm pretty sure of it. But okay, trying to deal with that with a new project. And one of the things is the rear builds. That's all there for already 10 years almost. I'm using the OpenSUSE build service. This is a basic of every day when there is a new release, it's up there. So you can always have the latest release. And there are also stable releases, of course, but okay. It is there. We have support. The free support is, I'm going the wrong way. The free support, I must say, is very good because the guy from SUSE is almost dealing there on a daily basis. So I think it's not bad. There's also commercial support for companies who are enforcing it. So they can talk to me. All right, rear automated testing. How does it work? This is a try to make a picture how it is today. Doesn't mean that it will be the same over a couple of years or a couple of months. Let's start with GitHub. GitHub is the central repository where the rear is stored. And also the rear automated testing software is also stored over there. So we have two rear there, and that is the symbol for the automated testing. It's a kind of circle because we always repeating the tests for each new release, and also stable releases are a possibility. This is the open build service, so that making RPMs of Debian packages. So that's there. What is the purpose of the rear automated testing? I want to simulate a full cycle with a client VM, server VM, and then recover VM. So here, how do we make those boxes available? Because I'm using Vagrant or Libvirt. That's also a possibility, but most boxes I'm using are using VirtualBox. So that's why I put here VirtualBox is the central component to build up the boxes. The boxes are coming from here. I even made one new Vagrant box for /11 because I was asked to build a /11 test case. So that was not existing, or the ones that I found were very crappy and not fulfilling my needs. So I made one myself. So it was an interesting task. You can find it on my GitHub pages if you want to know how I did it. Important to know is that these boxes, okay, it's a plain box. For example, the server, that should be an NFS server also. It is also a Barrios server, but because for Barrios, they hired me to make their automated testing. If they make a new release of Barrios backup software, I do their testing with a stable release of rear to prove to their customers that it's working. They pay me for it. So that's why Barrios is in here. So I have to install Barrios over there, also on the client. And how I'll do it, I use Ansible for that. So the playbooks are also part of the automated testing project. You can find everything on the internet, how I'll build it. Another interesting piece is, how do we prove that the client is recovered successfully? And that this client is recovered successfully on the recover? It boots up. Are you happy? Most of the time, you're already happy that something comes up. But for doing that, I used to have some inspect rules from Red Hat, but they are too Redis. So because I also do a Debian or doing SLES and other kinds, Red Hat, I said, okay, let's drop it. I'm using now Inspect. Inspect is something from Ceph. It's a compliance testing software. It's open source also. I love it. I use it in several companies to prove, for example, after patching that before and after everything is working fine, security-wise, operational-wise. And these things I also use. And then everything is locked, the recovery log, the backup log, the automated testing logging, and also the inspection before and after are written, in a configuration file, or a configuration file in a text file, and that text file, I publish it on the internet, on GitHub also, via GIST. Because I have to prove to the customer, Barrios, for example, and the other customers who are asking me to do the test, that okay, this is the proof that it does work, right? So this is, in fact, the picture. If you have any questions, I'm thinking of it, for example, that the server here, because I'm using more VirtualBox, and VirtualBox is using more the host itself to BigZip booting. So less and less the server has a need for BigZip booting. For Lifert, I use the server, for example, but for VirtualBox, you have to use the box itself, the host. And also, NFS has to be exported because all my evidence from the client and from the server are putting on a local file system, which is on the host, so you need to mount it anyhow. So I'm thinking to replace the server by a Docker instance. The only thing I needed is for Barrios, and then I can use the Barrios backup server in a Docker instance. So that's the next thing that I want to do. Excuse me? You will see it. I will give a live demo. So initially, the project was written for customers with a subscription contract of Rear. But it was using CentOS 7. That was the first one that I supported. That was a little bit more than a year ago. Then Ubuntu came, 14 and 16, and now since last month, in fact, the slash 11 and slash 12 were also included. So for that one, slash 11, I made a vagrant box. And I already told I'm using Ansible to configure the client and the server before I can do something with it. You have to install Barrios client, you have to install on the server, the NFS server, you make all the things you need to do with a simple client. It have to be a usable environment to prove that something is working. Right. Good. So what does it do? Well, first of all, it starts up the client and the server VM. That is the script that I will demonstrate. The first thing it will do, it will make a disaster recovery image, put it on the server or on the vagrant host. You can define that through Rear itself. Rear has a configuration file for it. What is included in the Rear automated testing? These things are, in fact, part of the Rear configuration. You can use NetFS that is using GNU TAR. That's just an internal one. That's the one I will demonstrate. Also, for the fun, I added duplicity and dupli. So that's the proof that the client and server is really communicating over an rsync backup. And of course, also Barrios, that's the wine. The guys who hired me in the first place to do their work a bit on the automated testing. There are two methods. I can use Pixie and ISO booting as a methodology to recover your image, and then I restore the data, I reboot or recover, and then do the tests again. Does it fulfill the client? Is it the same on the recover? Okay. This is, in fact, the picture of it. I think you get the picture effect. That's the host and the client and the server are kicked off, and you do your stuff with the client, you make your disaster recovery image, you put it on the, or here, or over there, If you're using Lifert, I put it on the server. If you're using VirtualBox, I put it on the host. So, and then you just stop the client, and you kick off the recover, and then it recovers, and then it reboots, and then it should be the same as the client. So there are two networks. There's an internal network. There's an internal network, and you have a DHCP network. The DHCP network is important for the provisioning, because I can pull from the internet. Also, the Rear automated testing, pull from the internet the latest version of Rear, if I want to test the latest version. So I can do it every day. Every day, if there's a new version, I can test it. Okay, setting up. The vagrant box, okay, it's quite clear that you need a host system. It was built for Linux, but it works on the Mac too, and this is the Mac. Most of the times I use VirtualBox. In the beginning I used also KVM libvirt, but most recent boxes are only for VirtualBox, so I'm using more and more VirtualBox now. You need, of course, Vagrant, and if you do libvirt, you need the plugin. You need the Git software, but these things you all have, of course. And to clone the Vagrant files, this is a project, rewrote method testing. If you clone it from the internet, you have all the required Vagrant files available. Okay, it's open source, so it's a GPL3, so anyone can use it. So new code is in effect only written for the customers who have a subscription request, but pull requests are or enhancements are welcome, of course. This is the URL where you can find it. You just do a git clone, go in that directory, and the minus h is for the help. There are not so many options, and it uses Vagrant, and the account is Vagrant or root Vagrant if you want to log in into one of the client or the server VMs. So once they are booted, you can just log in and inspect whatever you want to do with these VMs. Okay, this is the different ways to log in. With Vagrant itself, you can do a secure shell to it. You use the 3310 for the client and the 15 for the server. That's it. Or you can also use the VNC, and they have three ports for the client, server, and the recover. So if you use that, it's also a possibility. Vagrant is taking care of it, that this is available. Okay, try it yourself. Okay, that's I will give a demonstration, so I can skip that. Why do I use it, or why is it was written in the first place? It was a kind of validation process, that to see if we have a new commits, pull requests added, that the basic functionality of Rear is still working. So I most of the time use it daily. It's also used for bug hunting. It's for me very easy to set up an environment just to kick off the proper distribution, and it does it for me automatically. And then I can do my compliance checks, which I find very, very useful. And these are not finished. That's an ongoing thing, of course. And also to prove that the unstable versions are rather stable, put it that way, I also have an option to test the stable versions, because Barrios, for example, is asking me that if they have a new version of Barrios, to test an older release with the new version of Barrios. So I can just say 2.2, 2.3, whatever, and it just pulls up and uses that thing. And also, if you want to test new integrations, it's just to make a new template for it. The template is a configuration of Relax and Recover, what is you're using in the live environment, except that I use I can show it, but it's just the server and the client are not written as that. It's very trivial. Voila. Time for a demonstration now. Good. This was the help page, as you can see. You have here, I don't know if very readable or not. The minus D option is for the distribution you want to test. You have the CentOS 7. You have the Ubuntu 14.04 and the Ubuntu 16. You have /11 and /12. That's a possibility. Then you have the boot method. There are two options there, Pixie booting or ISO booting, that you can have. The minus S option is if you want to use a stable version to test. But that is, if you don't use it, it is always the latest git commit from the unstable. Put it the unstable, the master trees in Git. The minus P is for the provider you want to use. The default is VirtualBox. If you want to use libvirt, you say just minus P libvirt. And the rest, you almost never use the minus L if you have a specific directory structure where you want to keep your logs, the logs that this software is creating, and you can show it. The minus T, I will remove it. That was the old Baker lib tests from Red Hat, minus H and the minus V. That's quite obvious. All right. So the defaults are CentOS 7, Pixie, VirtualBox. So in this case, because I'm using VirtualBox, I want to test CentOS 7, Pixie booting. I can just run the script without any option. So that would be CentOS 7 in this case. Just press enter. You can see here CentOS 7. I will starting up the client and the server boxes. Yeah, already started them to enhance or speed up a little bit. If you want to interrupt, this is saying, okay, the client and the server are now running. You know, that's the errors that you see here is from the Mac, but okay, doesn't matter. Resolving is not working well. Okay, it's already telling me that it is the backup is already running. And you can see here, if I could scroll up a bit, this is the configuration file from rear. You see here the output, it's Pixie booting, it's the prefix, the backup is netfs, this is the backup URL, the 15, so the backup is stored now on the server VM. And this is typically the location if you want to, for the configuration for Pixie booting, where he wants to write your Pixie environment to boot from. Static booting, okay. This is an option that I use to have aliases of your LAN interfaces. I don't want firmware files. That's to decrease the amount of backups. I explicitly add the password of the root. And I said, okay, I want time syncing. I'm using NTP date. And the location, and this is the location of my, where my log file will be stored. Yes? Yes. Yeah. But this is it's an internal testing system, so I don't care. Okay, maybe it's almost done now, you see, exiting. Okay, I wanted to give you some more so the backup was successful. Now it's halting the client VM. So you can see it here, shutting down. So that is driven by the rear automated testing script. Now it will start to recover VM. And then you see the VirtualBox console popping up. Pixie booting is started. It should find his boot area. Well, this is a live demo, so if it fails, well, it doesn't. Okay, it's good. So this is the menu, because it's unattended. I defined it unattended because I don't want to intervene with backups in this case. So let's do it all automatically. It defines everything, tries to define everything itself, if possible. If it's not possible, then it will just stop. You will see it's already busy with the restoring the data, so it goes faster. So in a live situation, it's the same thing. It's not cheating that I do here. I just say unattended. If you don't define unattended, if a Pixie recover mode or ISO boot recover mode or whatever, then it is stopping. Then you get a prompt, and then you have to say rear recover yourself. Now it's completely automated. That is the purpose of the automated testing that I don't want to have any work on it anymore. Just start it. Okay. Within 30 seconds it will reboot. I can just interrupt it now if I want to check something, but normally I start it up and go away. I forget about it, then all day later I say, oh yeah, I did the test. Okay. Wait a second, I close the window a little bit. All right. So it's rebooting now. Voila. That's booting up. And you should get your prompt within a few seconds. Well, of course, with system D, it lies. You get your prompt, but it's not started yet. All right. So as you can log in, you can just say Vagrant. You can say this is a client. That's my banner. That's added by Ansible. You say I get my IP address back. Maybe interesting to see. But you couldn't see, and this part here, it is green, greenish, and it's very bad, but green means good. This is produced by InSpec. InSpec is just a tool that can do some things on your client and to say whatever you want, in fact. You can check, is my root file system there? Is it owned by that? Is the mode that? It's just limited for the moment. I had for one customer already 800 rules. I just don't want to run 800 rules here because it takes almost 10 minutes sometimes. So I don't find it interesting, but I'm always keen to find new interesting rules that you say, oh, okay, why don't you test that? It's just a matter of a few minutes and can add them. But of course, I did not prove yet that the client VM, which is now the recover VM, has the same compliance rules, if are they still okay or not. At the end of the script, it tells me here, this is not yet automated. And the thing is, with VirtualBox, it's going well, but with Flipvert, it is waiting and waiting until I do a control C, and this is annoying. So if I may decide to stop with Flipvert, then I could also automate it, but okay. In this case, I still have to run it manually, and it would just tell me which command I should run. This is the inspect exec, the compliance checks with the key. And yeah, there is the output. Here is the output. It's all green, so that means that the client VM is successfully recovered on the recover VM. Voila, that's affected. This is what I wanted to show you as a demonstration. For the rest, let's see if there's something interesting. If you need more, I can show it here. I had some backup slides, but the backup slides are not important. The rear support you can find here. If you want to help with it, have ideas, they are always welcome. And for the rest, no, that's okay. That was not necessary. Any questions?
So your inspect test, have you made those into a profile?
Yes. Yeah, I can show it. This is effect, put it a bit higher. I'm now in the rear automated testing. This is the script. The script has now a few subscripts, not much, but okay. What you see here, if you see /11/12, Ubuntu 14.16/17 was never finished, and CentOS 7. These are the distributions which are tested. And if you want to know what's in there, not much. Some scripts that I can delete, that were my original scripts that I used over a year ago to provision. Just keep them as in the historical view. If you want to look at it, it's always nice. These are the vagrant file for libvirt or VirtualBox. So the script itself chooses libvirt or VirtualBox and copies it to the vagrant file. And then you have here the Ansible. The nice thing is that all the distributions that you have to test are using the same Ansible tree. They are all linked to the CentOS 7 Ansible. So I'm using block to differentiate between the different distributions. Okay, you can see it if I just say Ansible. You have here the client, common, and server. Things which are common are defined in the common tree, and the client, well, that's for the client, and the server is for the server, or whatever. And you find everything over there. If I do it like this, so that's a lot. Typically, the YAML stuff, playbooks, it's fun. Another thing that I can show. Well, what do I do now? The inspec, you were asking about inspec. These are the compliance checks. Typically, it's not so much about accounts, file systems, RPMs, system controls, but it can be enhanced as much as possible. That's no problem. And another interesting thing, well, the documentation is in the doc, what you see on the internet. If you look at the internet here, this website is inside the GitHub repository. So you can have a look over there. This is the repository itself. And if you want to make a pull request or an issue, you can do it over here. I can give another demo if you want, but I think the time is almost finished. Yes?
Is something you run every commit in continuous integration?
No, not yet. Okay. Not yet. Okay. Not yet, yeah.
I have a third question.
Yeah. I almost run it daily, that's true, but it's still interactive.
So why
started. Then you need a decent server.
Fair enough.
And I still run it from laptops for the moment, and maybe I should build a decent server, and then I can. I already have a small server for my repositories builds on the OpenSUSE build service. That's completely automated. It's a box which I forgot about, and that works automatically, so I don't have to do anything. But for this, I agree that. Should be done with a webhook or something like that.
Right.
No, that's.
Yeah,
I know. I've seen demonstrations with Jenkins already.
Cool.
Yeah. But okay. Any other questions?
Yes. So you showed NFS to store the backups.
Yes.
What kind of other storage is possible?
Oh. You mean Gluster?
That's NFS as well.
Yeah, that's true. You can do it with duplicity. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's included with duplicity, and there are users using duplicity with Amazon Web Storage. Yeah. And for the rest, I think any kind of backup solution you can think of, commercial and open source, is incorporated in Relax and Recover, except for Veeam. Yeah, that's the only exception. Who cares about Veeam? Oh, sorry. And for the rest, I think, it's limitless, almost. Because it's open source, you get a lot of pull requests and enhancements, things I never used. You can use it for cloning. It's used a lot for cloning. A new consultancy companies in New Zealand and in England who are doing it on a daily basis. They use it also for physical to go into virtual, from virtual to go to Amazon. Shlomo, for example, he works for now for the Dutch post, I think. Oh dear. A post. And he uses it daily now for migration purposes. Yeah. So, because it's so open, you can do anything with it. Okay. That was my talk about the automated testing.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.